Okay, part two. Then we're gonna go straight into it. I talked about labels and debates and why are they necessary. Point number four of why debates, labels, and convictions are necessary is because these labels and these doctrinal distinctives, they create unity within a church and teaches humility as a church. What do I mean? It creates unity within the church among one another, okay? So, you know how when everyone agrees with the same thing, there's just more unity, the bonds are in relationships and friendships are deeper, they get deeper faster, there's joy. When you hang out with people who you agree with the same values, it's just easier. And that just fosters warmth, love, acceptance, and unity, right? So that's something that is so beneficial in churches. I have seen, I have actually witnessed churches that don't have these doctrinal distinctives, and they end up fighting a lot. There's not much unity, and the church begins to have cliques. So there's a theological group, there's an Arminian group, a Calvinist group. So it has a tendency to be, I am with Paul, I am with Apollos, I am with Peter, you know, all this, I am with Jesus. So when you don't have those theological distinctives as a church, you end up fracturing the church from within, and that's very dangerous in my opinion. So yeah, that's one problem. So these doctrinal distinctives create unity within a church, and it creates humility as a church, meaning when you as an entire church, for example, are all Calvinists, like our church, we are 5-point Calvinists, we are cessationists, we are NCT as a church. When we meet people from other churches, we as a church are reminded to stay as humble as possible by the grace of God, to recognize that there are many other local churches that have different doctrinal distinctives, and we are, as long as they agree with the non-negotiables of Christianity, like salvation by grace through faith alone, salvation by grace alone, to faith alone, Christ alone, scripture alone, to God be the glory alone, if they believe that Jesus is indeed Lord, and that repentance is a requirement for salvation, and that God is triune. You know, if they hold to the non-negotiable doctrines of Christianity, we can embrace them as brothers and say, we're Calvinists, you're Arminians, that's totally cool, we love one another, we're brothers and sisters in the Lord. We can discuss these things passionately, but when there's an unbeliever present, we tag team and minister to the unbelievers. Or if we are cessationists and people are Pentecostals, we're like, hey, you know what, as long as we hold to the core doctrines, we might disagree on some issues, but when it comes to unbelievers, we tag team. So it teaches us humility as a church while it fosters unity within the church. That's point number four. Point number five, the reason why I think debates are necessary, it's because formal debates, facilitated debates, encourage respectful dialogue. You see, I've said this before, the purpose of debates is to arrive at truth, but at the same time, we're supposed to understand other Christians. We're supposed to know where they're coming from. I have had the joy and pleasure of discussing annihilationism, I've discussed Calvinism and Arminianism, I've discussed dispensationalism and NCT in online on Facebook groups that are very civil, very respectful, very warm, very loving. We may disagree, but we do so in a very good, very godly manner, and that's all by the grace of God, and I have had so much joy, encouragement, and pleasure to know that there are Christians out there who disagree with me and I disagree with them, but we still experience that love for one another. I've also seen groups and people who just disagree in a very, very bad way. For Calvinists and Arminians, I call this the Warminists and the Warminians. All right, so we should not have that kind of mindset. There still should be love, there should be understanding. We should put ourselves in the shoes of another person and not misrepresent them. The debate I talked about that I watched recently online, again, you can watch this in Striving for Eternity, Andrew Rapoport. The Arminian there, and I'm sad to say he's Filipino like me, but he just did nothing but misrepresent and then use logical fallacies. It seemed to me that he was more interested in winning the debate than representing the opposing view accurately. And to me, that's a sign of disrespect when you misrepresent another person just to win an argument. I think that's disrespectful and it's very disingenuous. All right, so facilitated debates with moderators help us understand one another, and it just makes the discussion more smooth, more respectful. There won't be any heckling. I've always learned so much watching debates from professional debaters like James White, who always gets into professional debates. And Paul did the same thing in the synagogues. And imagine if the Apostle Paul does it then, and he says it was his custom, and a lot of people learned and even got born again from those debates. I know that my wife actually got born again because of a debate. She was listening to her classmate debate her religion teacher about salvation, and that's how she got more curious about it, and that's how she got saved. It was from a debate. So yeah, debates are important. They are necessary. The last point, number six, that I would like to talk about is that debates and labels prevent the parachurch or pseudo-church mentality. As much as I love online groups, as much as I love fellowshipping with Christians from other churches, and as much as I appreciate interchurch fellowships, there is a danger with online groups and parachurch groups, okay, or pseudo-churches. The temptation is that people will have a deeper bond with these parachurch organizations than their local church. Now, the Bible does not encourage us to have these things. The Bible teaches us that we should be formal members of local churches. If your church does not have formal membership or what we call covenant membership, then I would strongly encourage you and suggest that you read about this topic, learn about this topic, read articles from 9marks.org, read the book, 9 Marks of a Healthy Church. It's so important that your church practices covenant membership. And there are several reasons for this. Reason number one, all right, sorry if it gets a little dark, I'm in the parking area of SM City. But reason number one for why this is important is because without a local church and with covenant membership, you miss out on transparency and accountability. Many times people try to be transparent and get accountability partners from people outside their local church. I think that does not work. It will not work for several reasons. They won't see if you're really attending church. They won't see if you're listening to the sermon. They won't see how you behave in front of the pastors. They won't see how you behave in front of other believers in the same church. They won't see how you behave, period. All they will see, all they will know about you is what you say to them. And so they cannot truly call you out if you're doing something wrong or questionable, right? So that's one thing. The other thing, in addition to no real transparency and no real accountability, is there's no real submission to authority. You can say all you want and insist all you want that you're submitting to these accountability partners, but you're really not. Because if you disagree with them, no one can do church discipline on you, because again, you're not in a church. You're in a pseudo church, you're in a parachurch. There's no real accountability, and there's no real submission to any kind of authority. So that's number two. The third reason why I think it's very not beneficial, and I'm going to turn on the lights soon because I'm in the parking lot already. This is not very bright. I apologize for that. But the last thing I want to say about this is, when you're not in a church, if you're in a parachurch, these labels disappear. They just disappear. You're going to have people who will be Arminians and Calvinists in the same parachurch. You're going to have cessationists and Pentecostals in a parachurch. They're all going to be different. And because everyone is different, what's going to happen is you're going to experience the problem that we talked about in number two, which is focus on spiritual growth is thrown into the side because you're more focused on the distinctives again. So I hope this helped. This is the reason why I think debates and labels are very necessary, and that local churches should have clear church distinctives as a church. I hope this helped. God bless you guys.